This week on We Hate Movies, the summer blockbuster extravaganza goes into video game town as we're talking about the long-awaited Street Fighter. I'm Andrew Jupin.
Steven Sadak.
Eric Siska.
Vinny Brusco.
And We Hate Movies. Welcome to We Hate Movies on the Sideshow Network. Thank you for tuning in, as always. This week, we welcome back our good friend, Vinny Brusco, to the show. How are you, sir?
I'm doing well. Thank you for having me, gentlemen.
It's been a... You'd call it a dog's age since you've been on the program.
I might call it a fortnight.
Well, a fortnight's like 2 weeks.
That's 2 weeks. And a dog's age...
What's a dog age?
That is, you buy a puppy and it dies eventually.
Oh, it's like that car commercial.
So it's definitely been a dog's age. Yeah.
Well, I think the last episode you were on was Spawn.
Spawn.
And I think we were still in the double digits.
Wow.
Yeah.
Wow. That was 1998.
Today we are indeed talking about Street Fighter from the great year of 1994, directed by mostly screenwriter Stephen E. D'Souza.
I think you say Stephen Sadak.
Yeah. Oh, wow. Dude, Steve. It would be a much different movie if I had my way with it.
Finally get my fingers on the Street Fighter script.
This guy's got some good credits to his name, though. He's got Die Hard, Commando.
The first two Die Hards.
Wow. Oh, well, I don't...
Story credit
said,
on Predator.
I said great credits.
Well, I'm just talking about credits.
Well, I'm just saying Die Hard 2.
48 Hours.
Yeah, the first 48 Hours.
Story credit on Predator, tons of stuff.
Crazy.
It's crazy that he would then go on to direct Street Fighter.
Well, let me ask a question, because I know where I stand. And we've talked about the Mortal Kombats on this show.
We've done both Mortal Kombats. See the back catalog.
Wait, there's two?
There's two.
Yeah.
Oh, right. I'm on We Hate Movies.
And you're both on both episodes.
I know. It came flooding back.
Where are you? I go Street Fighter as a game series way over Mortal Kombat. I always enjoyed it. I love the characters. I'm a bit of a Street Fighter head, a little bit.
Well, you were also a big fan of Nintendo.
Yeah.
Which Mortal Kombat was more of a Sega system game.
It was
game,
a little darker.
And then you had Nintendo and Street Fighter.
Well, it was bright and poppy, man. It's like listening to Weezer all day.
I had Mortal Kombat on Super Nintendo.
I know. I knew it existed, but it always felt like it was a Sega system game.
Yeah, I get because like the console was like dark. Yeah. No, I mean, we were a Nintendo household, but we were an MK household, man.
Okay. I dabbled in both.
Okay. I've played my share of Mortal Kombat.
You know, all I had was Street Fighter 2.
Uh-huh.
Loved the shit out of it.
Absolutely.
Had Mortal Kombat 1, 2, and 3, though.
Oh, wow.
So, I'll
take it up a level. Had Mortal Kombat 1, 2,
oh,
and 3.
Oh, sure. We had Shang Tsung.
I never owned a Street Fighter game.
Wow. Really?
Whoa,
what a disgrace.
Wow. Played the arcade tower, I did.
Wow. Leave your own house.
I loved myself some Super Street Fighter 2. That's where you get some Fei Long going on.
Yeah. You just explained to me what that was, because I have no idea.
They just upped the cast Street count pretty
much.
Yeah,
it was like four extra characters, and the bosses were like already unlocked. Mm-hmm.
Right.
You could be Balrog any day of the week. You want to wake up? Eat some Doritos and be Balrog. You go right ahead.
That's drink some Mountain Dew.
But, like, why would I want to be Balrog?
Nobody wants to be Balrog.
You're right.
He's slow.
Vega, on the other hand.
Oh, so agile.
There's those animes out there that I always wanted to watch, but I never did because I felt like that was the step down a dark path. Like, I start watching the Street Fighter animes, then I'm reading the comic books, and then all of a sudden I'm wearing an enormous Hawaiian shirt with, like, Blanca on it.
You're at some sort of, like... con that's not at like a major convention center, but like more at like just some hotel banquet hall.
Yeah, dude, anime, it changes.
You're watching octopus porn.
It's, oh, guaranteed.
Like, isn't that like half of it?
Yeah,
isn't
most
it,
like, of it.
No, that's not. That's a misnomer.
But that's a large market.
Yeah, it's a huge market.
There's enough people.
Steve, that library is endless.
Oh, it's deep.
I am going to stand up for the anime in general as an art form. However, I didn't watch the Street Fighters.
But so there's like television series? Is that the idea?
They're getting around, like, it's more about Ken and Ryu, who are the characters I liked, and they're just getting into cool fights with the Kuma and
fucking,
what have you.
Are they like jokes, though?
Oh, I thought you said, are they fucking?
Oh, no, I'm sorry. I should have like connected my
in
words
Steve's
faster.
Version
well, oh,
they
no,
are,
absolutely.
Yes. In Steve's slash fiction.
I can show you some binders.
It's right next to the tentacle porn.
Yeah, I bet you there's like something out there of Ken and Ryu fucking with like an octopus in between them.
No question.
That's what that stuff. That's what it is, man. I never really watched anime much. I watched like Vampire Hunter D and Akira.
Okay.
In my younger years, and I was like, well, that's pretty cool. And then I went on and never watched anime again.
See, I watched a bit of it, not like just the bigger ones, like Ghost in the Shell.
Oh, I saw that one too. That was a good one.
Ninja Scroll, which is one of the greatest movies ever. Fantastic movie.
Speaking of weird anime,
I watched some octopus porn. Some of the Final Fantasy stuff is pretty fantastic.
The rock monster rape in Ninja Scroll doesn't
age well.
He licks
his fingers.
Yeah, it's repulsive.
It's very uncomfortable.
Nobody likes that.
Try watching it with your mother. Very weird.
Well, Vincent, it's Christmas. Whatever movie you want to watch.
It's your special day. What do you want to watch?
Ninja Scroll.
Oh, my
Sounds
God.
Sounds exciting. Ooh.
Speaking of nobody likes it, the Street Fighter movie.
Yes, yeah, suck it, Street Fighter the movie. It's
oh,
this
sure.
Shit.
Really? You guys hate that much? I'm joking. It's a fucking terrible movie.
You know what?
It's like, borderline unwatchable. Like, I'm watching this movie, and I'm like, I gotta do an episode on it. I better pay attention. And then I'm just like drifting towards the wall. I'd rather watch the wall.
I'm sitting there going, man, I really wish I was watching the Mortal Kombat movie.
Yeah.
Not necessarily I wish I was watching Mortal Kombat Annihilation, because that's just barely a movie. But that first Mortal Kombat movie?
As evident that I forgot it existed.
I watched half this movie last night before bed, and then the other half I watched today while watching the Euro Cup and the Northern Ireland game on mute. And I was like, I have more entertainment watching this soccer game.
So wasn't that game awesome, man? It was fucking raining like hell.
It was awesome.
Oh, man, when Blanca scored that winning goal.
The World Cup is very much like a street. And here's my question.
Euro Cup.
How or the Euro Cup? Euro
get it right.
Whatever.
Thank you, fellow American.
Soccer is like the anime of sports.
That's the most ignorant thing we could say, and I love it.
But you know what? I kind of get what he's talking about.
Like you have
cult
very,
following, not you
it's
know.
Very, at least for the United States, the rest of the world thinks I'm a dipshit, ugly American. But
ugly American.
Ugly.
How hard is it to get a fucking martial artist director for a Street Fighter movie and just set like make it like pornography? Like all I want are like every 9 minutes, two people to fight each other. I want some fireballs coming out of some hands. I want a sonic fucking boom. God damn it.
Give me one sonic boom.
Exactly.
That's all
I need.
Here's the problem with that is like this movie is trying to put these characters in a realistic light. So how do you have Guile do a sonic boom? You can't do magic.
I think that he could say sonic boom.
Or maybe he's got like an experimental gun or something.
Yeah, they created Blanca. He could definitely throw out a fucking sonic boom.
Yeah, exactly.
If there is a Blanca in this movie.
If you can construct a green muscle monster, you can have a sonic boom rifle.
Maybe he's got some gauntlets or something.
Which, by the way, for Blanca, I love that they had the green and orange. And then if you notice, there was a bag of blue. So if you had Blanca's alternate character, it was blue.
Nice.
I was like, yes, nice.
That idea.
Well, this movie was made by the fans for the fans. Is that what you're saying?
Oh, wait. You're just like blowing my mind right now, Vinny, because Guile in this movie is, and a lot of the AN, because it's not UN,
it's
right?
Yeah. Oh, God.
They're dressed in blue camo, which is the bizarro Guile, the double
Correct.
Of Guile. Guile wears green camo in the game.
Yep.
Blue camo.
If you choose two of them.
If you do two of them. So was this an alternate Guile that Van Damme is portraying and not the real Guile?
I am from the Shadow Universe.
Wasn't it?
There's a better Street Fighter movie in the real universe, but I'm from the Shadow one. You picked two Street Fighter movies and this one came out.
But in Street Fighter Turbo, though, like, wasn't his default character blue?
I think in Street Fighter Turbo, one of the upgrades was you get to choose either or.
Yeah.
Regular
What the fuck is Street Fighter Turbo?
That's it.
We just said.
Did we?
Here's the thing. It's when there's four extra characters and the bad guys are already unlocked.
Okay. Street Fighter 2.
Wait, then what is Super Street Fighter? And is there a Super Street Fighter Turbo?
There's Super Street Fighter 2. There's no Super Street Fighter Turbo. That's stupid, Eric. The thing is, Street Fighter...
They said that snood. I was like, no, that's not that
Capcom
game.
Knew
oh, man, snood the movie?
Oh, the amazing. Be better than
I'm
this piece of
snood
shit.
Now.
Oh, look out. I am here with my blue face snood.
Here's the
try
thing.
To get me purple square.
Oh, no.
Dude, I'm sorry. If you can make a fucking Angry Birds movie, you can make a snood movie.
I was going to say Raul Julia is the purple square.
Oh, man. R.I.P.D.
Mm-hmm.
Well, so M. Bison in this movie, as portrayed by the late, great Raul Julia.
Should we do a plot synopsis? Does that even make any
There's
sense?
There's a plot to this movie?
M. Bison, Guile runs the Allied Nations, the AN's army force, and M. Bison's a bad guy, and that's kind
of
it.
Well, M. Bison is kind of like the Donald Trump of this world, because he's just a weird land developer who wants to build this fucking mall. He wants to build a mall. That's the plot.
Bisonopolis.
Bisonopolis, exactly. In Shadaloo, his fake country that
Which,
he
again,
owns.
Wasn't sure if that was fake. In the
right. Now, that we had a little debate about this earlier. Now, that is apparently a fake nation.
Uh-huh.
Okay.
Yes.
Okay. Because
somewhere in Southeast Asia.
Right.
Yeah. Fake.
Not Thailand. I think it's probably like, I feel like Bison just kind of like, annexed some of Thailand and started calling it Shadaloo.
Oh, that could right.
You think so? Oh, do you just think built some fences and was like, yeah, this is me now.
Maybe cross the border into Cambodia a little bit like Nixon did. You know what I'm saying?
Like it's a little dicey down there.
You know, like, that's the thing. It's just like, hey, he's a dictator in the Far East, yet it's kind of Eastern European at the same time.
Yeah, I mean, it's, I mean, yeah.
It is what it is. It's Shadaloo. You can't describe it. It's its own thing.
I would vacation there.
And a bad sign for M. Bison is that his costume gets its own credit.
That's always the kiss of death, dude. They did it in that first Judge Dredd movie.
Uh-huh.
Like someone demanded upfront credit for that piece of shit, too.
Well, here's the thing. If costume design should have its own credit, like, you know, the costume designer is X.
Well, I mean, they give it Oscars.
They give it Oscars.
This could have been an Oscar.
But this movie is saying, like, there's a costume designer who did everybody else, and then one person worked on this thing that
night
makes
and day.
Raul Julia look like a fucking Darkwing Duck villain. Like, come on. It looks terrible. And it's, like, I guess video game accurate, but in these situations, you need to adapt the video game costume into the real world. Not just translate it because you look like a clown.
Like they did with Guile's hair.
Yeah, they made it manageable. Yeah.
Exactly.
Which I don't know. I was like, I kind of want a little bit higher.
Can you imagine if Jean-Claude Van Damme had a fucking kid and play, high and tight fucking haircut like he's got in the game?
Oh, my God. It would have been amazing.
I would be trashing it if it happened, but I kind of want to see
it. Me too.
It,
right? I was going to say, the time I was like, it's a little orangey and like it's not as sharp as I want it to be.
There's got to be some
sharp. It needs to have the right shape.
Yeah,
you know what I mean?
It looks like you just got, like, towel dried it. Like, I want it to be like some gel in there.
And this movie's like so like strict to like, we got to shove in every fucking character there ever was.
Well, that's like, all these video game movies do
but
that.
But why?
Because you never know whose character is the favorite.
Mm-hmm.
Well,
so it's like someone's going to see Mortal Kombat because they love Kano. You better have fucking Kano
in
that movie.
Let's compare it to, now you guys both, I don't know about Vinny, but these guys love Gambit.
Yeah.
X-Men have yet to do Gambit. And guess what? I don't know. Maybe
I'm gonna tell
the world
you why they haven't done Gambit,
but maybe the world is better without Gambit.
I understand.
At least the first seven fucking movies or whatever we're up to,
because he's such a favorite character amongst people.
Uh huh.
Yeah.
They just don't like Wolverine. Like everybody likes Wolverine. He's like Batman. Yeah. You need to have Wolverine. Yes. Gambit's kind of an offshoot, but he's so loved and adored.
Yeah.
You gotta nail him. You gotta do it right.
You gotta do it right.
And that's the thing.
You can't just throw out Gambit.
They did, and it failed. In that Wolverine movie, nobody liked it.
Oh God, Dreamy Ryan Reynolds.
Stay tuned. No creepy. What's his name?
Taylor Kitsch.
Taylor Kitsch, yeah. I was going to say Tim Riggins. That's who we played on Friday Night Lights. But yeah, that failed. But you don't, like, if it's, especially if it's a game where it's like, you have the power to pick who you want to be every time.
Right.
all of those picks have to be represented.
The weird thing is,
though, I don't know about that.
I mean, I disagree with it, but that's the mindset of the game.
Sure.
It's kind of racist that this is Guile's movie because the Street Fighter is Ryu's. It's the Ryu show. Yeah, exactly.
100%.
Much like Mortal Kombat's Liu Kang, and that movie rightfully is like, hey, we can follow an Asian man in a movie. Yeah. You know what I mean?
Well, like, yeah, but it's also like it's a double-edged sword, Steve, because Ryu is so boring that it's like a clean slate.
In this movie?
Which is good for the audience because then you can project yourself onto this clean slate of a not character that Ryu was.
Yeah, sure.
I mean, he looked cool and he had a... I mean, he looked standard. That's the thing.
Yeah, he didn't look very cool in
and,
this movie.
And Ken looks even worse.
To be honest, he looks like shit.
God, that guy looks like he fucking flunked out of the Cobra Kai. This Ken. He looks terrible.
The Ken in this movie or Ken in general?
Ken in the movie, okay. Man.
But
he looks
like
terrible.
In general, too. And that's the, my point is like, you know what, Ken? Maybe Street Fighter 2 if we get to it. We don't need Ken in this movie.
Yeah, why are they such a team like that?
They're, I mean,
so
I
much so that in the intro of the cartoon, which see our Animation Damnation episode, in the intro, when they introduce Ken and Ryu, they're fucking fate. Like, it's like half of Ken's face, half of Ryu's, and it comes together to make a weird looking person.
I will tell you why, is because they are literally the same character.
Right.
Because they both do the Hadouken.
Sure.
They both wear the karate gi. One's red, one's white.
They do the uppercut.
It's the same fucking character. That's
Is there a flying uppercut in the movie, by the way? Ken kind
of
does it at the end.
He looks at the camera after he does it. He's like, yeah, ladies and gentlemen, he's got the flying uppercut. You got
there, that's the best way to describe things in this movie. Everybody's kind of doing it.
Well, the whole entire time, the whole beginning of the movie, they're introducing the characters. It's like, I don't know, E Honda.
I was a sumo, but then I got kicked out for pooing my pants too much.
So now I'm a cameraman in this movie?
I'm also a cameraman. My name is Balrog, and I was a boxer.
Why isn't he just a boxer?
Or, like, what? But why?
Because
do
what business does a boxer have in this fucking political conflict? That's the problem. This movie is centered around, like, an international incident. So you have to figure out ways to get all these people there. A boxer's got no business being there.
You know what, dude? You give me 20 minutes and $40. I'll write Balrog into this movie, and he'll be a goddamn boxer.
You know what's pathetic and sad? Is there
Balrog in this movie?
Yes, but there's also a terrible Jean-Claude Van Damme movie that... I mean, fuck, there's two of them.
I mean,
that better represents Street Fighter, and that's Bloodsport and The Fucking Quest, which my DVD of Street Fighter, because shit, I own this.
You own this movie?
Yeah, because I bought a 4-pack of Van Damme, bro. I bought it for I bought it for Time Cop.
Is Sudden Impact in there?
No, it's...
Or Double Impact?
It's Time Cop, Hard Target, I think.
Ooh.
That's a good one, right? That's a good disc.
Yeah.
The other... the second disc...
See our episode on Hard Target, by the way.
Is Street Fighter...
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, and Time Cop. Dupe, duped out, man. So the second disc is Street Fighter and The Quest. And now, have you guys seen The Quest?
I've never seen The Quest.
No, I've never seen The Quest. No.
Oh, man, dude. That's a stay tuned and a half. Because basically that is... It's like classy blood sport. Wherein... Jean-Claude Van Damme is like in the 1920s.
Oh.
And it's like everyone has to go and like all these nations send their best fighters.
That's Street Fighter. Nation. That's all I want.
Exactly. Let's enter the dragon. That's
yeah,
what
well,
I
mean,
well,
that-
yeah, it's everything. But I feel like Street Fighter is better geared towards that kind of plot, like The Quest or Bloodsport or, you know, whatever.
Yeah, just like underground fighting.
Exactly.
Yeah.
Well, also, yeah, just pretend that, like, there's a fighting thing, and like then, a fighting tournament.
And then set it in Shadaloo, which is anything goes, bro.
Well,
but
it's just
the
like
government
Outworld.
Cracks down, and now you got to kill the fucking government.
Or even, like, you know, M. Bison holds the world hostage, right? He's got a million nukes. He's like, everyone has to come to Shadaloo to fight me, and whoever wins will win. There
That's
you
all.
Go. That's Street Fighter. Done.
I have a question. Balrog.
Uh-huh.
Originally, Danny Glover, maybe? They were trying to get Danny Glover in there?
Maybe, yeah.
Because they got a really $2 version of Danny Glover.
The haircut they put on this poor bastard is just like... it looks like he's just losing all of his hair.
Oh, it's so bad.
Isn't that a name of a demon in Lord of the Rings?
Yeah, it's
Isn't that what, like, Gandalf, like... breaks the damn bridge about?
There is some. I was doing some Street Fighter Wikipedia.
Oh, I bet that's nice and filled.
It's a lot.
Sure.
Apparently, like, there's a lot of versions, early versions, where Vega and Balrog had their names switched, kind of a thing. Like, because none of the names actually meant anything. You know what I mean? Like,
right.
So,
well, by the way, Balrog in this movie is played by character actor Grand L. Bush, who you may remember as one of the two FBI agents in the first Die Hard movie.
Oh, that's nice.
There's some useless trivia for you.
Wow, so that's
Grand L. Bush.
That's where Stephen E. D'Souza found him.
So he'll make a good Balrog.
Might be, yeah. Oh, and also, I think Stephen D'Souza directed or wrote the screenplay for another Van Damme movie. Was it Knock Off? He wrote one of like the latter like terrible late 90s Van Damme movies.
Man, there's so many terrible ones.
So we start with M. Bison takes 60 some odd people hostage. And Chun-Li's like working for like a GNN, fake CNN kind of a thing. She's doing a report on it. M. Bison's watching it in his impossible warehouse. And the funny thing is she interviews Van Damme, Colonel Guile. And she's like, Colonel, how are you going to get, you know, do you have any message for M. Bison? He's like, I've got the message. And he gives this, like, he kind of
fuck you.
Kind of a fuck you, but it's also
yours,
just kind of flexing
his
bicep. It almost knocks M. Bison's hat off. He's very upset about it.
He can't believe that got through on Shadaloo broadcast television.
His hat almost spins around.
That would be, his
can't believe
comes out of his ears.
He's so furious. He's so fucking furious.
But
the
funny thing is, so, like, here's... You know, I'm this guy. I'm Colonel Guile. My best friend, Charlie, just got kidnapped. Nobody knows who her best friend.
Right.
You know what I'm not going to do? Give him a shout out on the news yeah. when Bison is watching it. Like, I'm going to tell Bison to go fuck himself. Be like, Charlie, it's going to be okay, buddy. Don't worry about it. I'll come for you.
What I love, though, is that this he's supposed to be giving an interview on what I'm told by the movie is a major news outlet.
Sure.
Okay? And what he basically
even
does,
though a sumo wrestler's running the board and a boxer's holding the fucking camera, but sure.
Dude, he looks like fucking Ric Flair giving a backstage interview to Mean Gene Okerlund. He is fucking yelling into the camera and talking to, oh yeah, oh yeah, Bison, you fucking son of a bitch. I'm going to get you, man. I'm going to fucking get you next summer at SummerSlam. Going to fucking get you.
By the way, don't hurt my friend Charlie. He's about 5'9". He's got black hair.
Chance of good he's in your clutches.
This shows you that this is bizarro, Guile. Yeah. Because the regular Guile is American, and this voice, man.
Well, didn't Van Damme audition to play somebody else?
No, he was...
Johnny Cage.
He was.
Oh, that's right. He turned down Johnny Cage to do this or something, right?
That's good what call. Steve told me.
Yeah, well, Johnny Cage is supposed to be like, you know, a Tom Cruise type character.
Yeah, no,
so.
But, yeah, I guess...
I mean, either way, it doesn't work, because as Eric pointed out, Guile's also supposed to be American,
yeah,
but,
no,
you know...
Terrible.
So then, what? Like, Raul Julia instantly finds yeah. Charlie, and it's just like, oh, you're Charlie. Guile's friend, you know?
Yeah,
and
well, he's standing like, but turn you into Blanca, dude. That's fucked up.
But his real name is Carlos Blanca uh-huh. or something.
Well, because Raul Julia puts the pieces of this puzzle together because...
he's an evil genius, to be fair.
Yeah, give him credit.
You see Bison and he's just like, Carlos, Charlie, you're Charlie. And I'm like, well... That was a real A to D there,
but he's
Bison.
Also like broken the necks of two other people. He's like, "Fight me now!"
That was a nice opening for the movie, I have to say. Seeing a couple fucking neck breaks,
yeah, I thought one of those. I thought one of those dead meats was a character actor, Greg Grunberg.
But then we guys like, "Oh, oh, that's that guy." Oh, all right. Oh, well, I got him anyway, Guile. You fuck.
And then he sends him away to his laboratory.
Oh, it's an evil laboratory is what it is.
Dude, it looks like the set of a Power Rangers episode.
It's amazing.
Where was the money for this movie? Everything is cheap as fuck. I mean, you're trying to essentially make like a video game adaptation crossed with a James Bond movie.
Well, yeah. Here's the thing is the IMDb Tribune told me that D'Souza turned down payment for this movie to pay the cast.
I feel like that was like Van Damme. I better get my money, bro.
Oh, yeah.
You know what I mean? Like, he's standing outside of his house. He takes his shirt off. Like, you better not be getting paid. I'm getting paid. Y'all.
A bunch of street fighters intimidated him.
And then Blanca's out there. He turns into electricity. No, it wins.
Well, so let's talk about the creation of Blanca, because I didn't know this until
I read.
Incredibly
important.
Well, I didn't know this one key detail until I read the credits the next day. I saw this. Dalhausen?
Dalseem.
Dalseem. Oh, excuse me.
Yeah, that's all right.
Yoga Flame.
See, that's he's not the video game Dalsy.
No, not at all.
He's just a nerdy character actor who was also in Gandhi.
He's just a scientist.
Yeah, and he's chained up. So in the video game, Dalseem has like those big bangles on.
Yeah.
So it kind of works in that regard.
Not really, but sort of. And that's what they're trying to go for sure. Yeah. And he's also, I believe.
Yeah. He doesn't look like a fighter either.
No, he's
this
not.
Guy's a little pudgy, man.
He's a little doughy.
He's been riding a desk for a while, to be fair.
Well, that's that's why he doesn't participate in the street fighting.
Also, why name him after the character? Why bring... That's the thing, is like,
because
we have to connect.
No, that's what I'm saying. That's what I'm saying, dude.
No.
For all those people in their basement who was like, I love playing
bad
as Dalseem.
Bad movie. Bad movie.
That's why it's Dalseem, dude.
But to Eric's point, and I kind of agree, it's like, why would I want that version of Dalseem? Like, save him for the sequel. I don't need, like, Wayne Knight playing fucking Nightwing in the new Batman movie because they didn't get to him yet. Like, oh.
Actually, I want that.
Wayne Knight is going to be Nightwing, but that just means he's the computer guy.
Hello, Bruce.
Yeah, exactly. Like, no, I want the version of the character somewhat.
Nightwing. You remember when Wayne Knight played Microchip in that second Punisher movie?
Spoiler alert, he gets shot in the face.
God, I love it. Oh, Wayne Knight get murdered.
But, he's been chained up by M. Bison, and M. Bison is trying to make a super soldier.
Why would you use someone who's your natural enemy to be a super soldier? Use someone that's sympathetic to your cause.
Absolutely.
Don't try to change him by showing him a bunch of pictures of
him. Just throw Zangief in there. They had
Zangief.
And he's got better stock. Zangief is cut in this movie.
He's already like two-thirds of the way to being a monster anyways.
And he's simple. He'll follow your orders. He doesn't need to be paid as we
learn.
Right,
we find that out. Oh, that's right. The gag about Zangief didn't know everybody else was getting paid for this gig.
Yeah.
He was... is he Leatherface in those...
Is he really?
In the remakes there?
I think you're right about that. I'd have to check the Tribune, but yeah. I feel like you're right about
yeah,
that.
He's gone back.
Wow, do not worry about Zangief. He's
oh, no, he's doing
all right.
You look like that, you're gonna be fine.
You got some roles coming to you. My favorite part about this is M. Bison... gives the world 3 days to give him $1 billion.
$20 billion.
What? But he gives him 3 days.
Now, is it 20 billion?
It is 20
billion.
Billion.
Yeah,
in
yeah.
my house, for some reason, I was hearing 20 million. I was like, that's not that much.
It's a little cheap, Bison.
I know you live in the developing world, but come on.
But also, this timeline makes no sense as the movie goes on.
What, the 3 days? Why so? You're getting a lot of them sleeping at night?
Well, no, not even that. But just like so then we cut to Ken and Ryu, who are a bunch of Han Solos. We'll call it that.
Don't
they're
do
like
that.
Han Solo.
don't do
yeah,
that.
Yeah, I agree. Do not say
don't
that.
Don't do that.
Actually, I just want to smack you for saying
yeah.
that. You can, but you have to yell Hadouken before you do it.
It's a good. That just sweetens the deal. Yeah.
Man, it was pretty cool when Eric hit Steve in the face, but it was even cooler because he yelled Hadouken right before he did it.
But you know what the problem is? That would turn you into Ken Masters, you big blonde.
And you know what I don't need, by the way, is backyard wrestling in my house, so that can just stop right now.
Well, you need a yard for that.
So they're like... They're selling coke to Dalseem. No, not to Dalseem. To Sagat.
Sagat.
They're
yeah.
selling weapons.
They're
not coke.
Yeah, they're gun runners.
They've sold coke before. That's how this started.
Wait, how are you comparing this to Han Solo?
No, listen, Han Solo is wrong, but they definitely sold coke before. Let's just get this straight.
Spice. Yes. Now if they were actually selling coke, see the thing is you don't see them sell coke in this movie.
No, you don't. I mean, I just get it from Ken's shirt mostly.
And, I mean, right. Listen, they're the kind of characters in these movies where, like, you know, they don't answer to anybody. So, they probably sold coke, weapons.
Opium.
Yeah. Women.
Ken, we're home.
Ryu, played by Chewbacca. By the way, better casting.
Oh, big time.
Dude, save yourself some money. Just make Chewbacca Blanca.
Yeah.
Just dye that suit green.
Have Chewbacca play all the characters.
It'd be a better movie.
Chewbacca's one-man show on Broadway, Street Fighter.
I love it.
Man, that would be hard to find a producer. So, yeah, the world has 3 days to give Bison $20 billion.
So we cut to Ken and Ryu are trying to sell
Saget.
Stuff to Saget.
Right.
Or Bob Saget.
Bob Saget.
Bob Sagat. why wasn't Bob Saget playing Sagat? He's tall, he's lean, he looks more like Sagat than this dude does.
That's actually true.
Just give him a patch.
Yeah.
And oil him up, take his shirt off.
And then Ryu almost fights Vega in a cage match.
In what should be street fighting.
Exactly. Oh, cool. You know what? It's been 12 minutes. Here's a street fight. Ryu versus Vega. It's kind of like Vega's level.
Outside. It was Vega's level. Yeah, the cage was awesome. I was like, all right, this is the coolest part of the movie.
And that makes sense for Shadaloo City. And apparently Vega's been the best street fight. Cage fighter since
Sagat.
Iron Fist, who was Sagat. Yeah.
Yeah.
What's that referencing, by the way?
Is that a Marvel comic?
No, I mean, I just think that he had to give himself a fake old name.
A cool name. Yeah. Now that I went legit, I'm going by my last name.
My God-given name?
Yeah, my surname.
Oh, that's his surname, you think? So he's like Benny Sagat or something?
He's Bob Sagat.
He's Bob Sagat.
you gotta be Bob Sagat.
At night, I host these cage fighters in the back of my warehouse. But by day, I'm the host of a viewer-programmed VHS tape mail-in show, predominantly featuring men being hit in the nuts.
And cats.
Well, the thing is, he hit a lot of men in the nuts back when he was a cage fighter.
That was his move.
And he had a lot of cats.
You know, by the way, just to derail this further.
Please.
You know who's hosting AFV these days?
No.
Sagat?
Dude, ABC Family would never sign off on that.
JCVD?
No, even better, dude. Alfonso Ribeiro.
Really?
Yeah. And no. Carlton.
I know who that is.
Well, you just looked at me like you didn't know who Carlton was.
No, I looked at you, I was going to throw up.
Dude, he's
that
perfect
sucks.
For it.
Yeah,
he's perfect.
Thank
for
you,
it.
Eric.
He's that's perfectly cheesy.
Yeah, yeah. It's the exact amount of cheese that you need for something like that.
That's fine. Well, he's better than that other guy. I hated that old gross white guy that's on Dancing with the Stars.
Oh yeah, what is that disgusting?
Oh, Tom Bergeron.
Yeah, that guy. That you want to talk about wanting to throw
up? Fuck that guy. I'd rather have Tom Sizemore host that shit.
Yikes. They wouldn't let Tom Sizemore near the set of Dancing with the Stars. Thank you very much.
He's the unemployable Tom Sizemore for a reason. And he's definitely not getting hired by ABC Family.
By the way, this $20 billion to not kill like
60 people?
60 total tops. I have a feeling the world governments would be like, you know,
light them up.
Yeah.
They're all in the pit, the 60 people. And it seems like there's a lot more than 60, but at the end, I'm going to spoiler alert, they all get away and it's like 12 people.
Yeah.
I was counting. I was like, those people were not in the pit. I was like, where'd the rest of them go?
By the way, the end game of Blanca is so that he becomes this monster that just eats and rips these people apart.
Yeah.
Yeah.
They call it guns, M. Bison. Just use them.
And they bring out all this like, they got to inject Blanca with all this weird, like, mutagens and genetic material and stuff. It's like, you want to kill 60 people, man? I can tell you how to kill 60 people.
Yeah, you don't need mutagens and fucking brainwashing to do it.
60 bullets is a lot cheaper.
I'll tell you what, man. You got to be careful with the mutagens. Next thing you know, you got Ninja Turtles on your hands.
That's true.
It's a real problem.
Well, this is kind of a Ninja Turtle.
He's more Ninja Turtle than not.
He looks like the Geico caveman.
he's a Geico caveman crosses the Ninja Turtle.
When you're making these like muscly monstars and whatnot, you gotta watch it with the eyebrows
and the nose.
Neanderthal bridge.
Yep, yes. It's real tough.
Made famous by Arnold Schwarzenegger.
In what?
In his face.
I was like, were they doing him up for Conan? No, you're just making fun of a person.
Which was on, by the way, the other day. And I was like, oh, this is a great movie.
That first Conan? That's right where you want to be.
Yeah, then, Crumb laughs at your four wins. There's no four crumbs, excuse me.
It's a cupcake place.
Four crumbs. It's a Conan the Barbarian themed cupcake restaurant.
I love that idea.
Right?
James Earl Jones is there?
Yeah. Could I get a Red Sonja?
Oh, yeah, yeah, dude.
That'd be a good cupcake movie.
I've actually never seen that movie, so I can't make any more jokes.
You're probably okay.
Yeah,
and Conan the Destroyer? Yeah. Fuck that movie. That's terrible.
Yeah, I'm on board for both those movies.
Really?
Yeah. Ride or Die with them?
I don't know about
the
that.
Barbarian
exotic,
is,
but...
is inarguably the best.
Yeah.
So... One of my favorite characters in this movie is Vega, who's like a flamboyant Wolverine slash Jason Voorhees kind of character.
Sure.
So he's Ryu's got to fight him.
Yeah.
When there's this one moment where they're like inevitably Ken and Ryu are captured or whatever, and so they have to like fight this dude.
Well, here's the thing: Sagat's like, oh, you know, they go in and go do some business,
right?
It's like, oh, can I offer you a drink? And then he goes, or something else. And these two bodacious babes come out,
totally bodacious.
And like, I
this
just
is a prostitution thing.
Well, that's what if they were like, yeah, let's I want to have sex. Dude, like, what if they stopped everything? Like, no, like literally,
dude.
Let me get my nut off first.
That's a thing. Like, you don't get to the high rungs. Of like doing like mysterious gun deals. If you're like, yeah, I want to let me just see those ladies first.
Well, no, see, that's the thing. If you go for it, man, if you go for it,
yeah,
then Sagat's just correct. Like, these guys love to have fun.
Well, also,
these guys know how to party.
If you go for it, then you're just in one of your animes.
That's probably a deleted scene in the anime or the whole scene of definitely. The anime.
Ken and Ryu are like, you got any octopi back there? To...
Oh, but of course.
Yeah, this is Southeast Asia. Come on. This is Shadaloo. Come on.
They're grown on trees.
But Guile breaks in through a tank and gives one of my favorite line deliveries in this movie, which is, you're all under arrest.
Under arrest.
Because Van Damme is hitting all the wrong words when you try to say the right thing.
It's amazing, though, because like you watch Van Damme movies before this and after this, and you're like, this sounds like this was his first English language movie for some reason.
Yes.
Like, he wasn't caring.
They should have overdubbed him.
A lot of dubbing in this movie, no?
Yeah,
it feels like it.
Not Captain from Sawada.
Oh, man, I was watching this like, is anyone talking in this movie?
It's like Mystery Science Theater.
Jesus Christ.
Before Van Damme breaks in with that tank, though, there's this amazing moment where, like, fucking Ryu's about to fight Vega, and then, like, he's... Well, I guess the fight starts, and he's kind of getting his ass kicked, and Ken is standing back with Sagat, and he goes... Why are you making me watch this? And I was like, I'm thinking the same thing about this movie. Ken, thank you very much.
With his sweater vessels, a substitute teacher in the beginning of this movie. So then they get arrested. This is where I'm talking about the time frame. So the beginning is Bison, and he puts Blanco, whatever. He's got 3 days. These guys get arrested. They get processed. They're in the yard, and then Vega breaks out a shiv that looks like his hand thing.
Yeah, where was he hiding that, by the way?
I think he made
ass.
It.
Very carefully, yeah.
Piece by piece, he took it out of his ass.
I don't understand it. Like, how fast did he make this glove thing?
Can we go back for like 3 seconds
of course.
Here? When they do the transaction, and then Sagat finds out that where the guns were and blah, 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 and then they bust out the guns, and they're filled with fucking Nerf balls.
Oh, right.
That's stupid.
And I was like, this is a perfect 90s movie.
I was thinking, like, you should instantly kill these guys for selling
absolutely.
You bogus shit, right?
Well, no, he tries to by physical combat, and then they're good. He's like, oh, you'll be my new cage fighters.
Yeah. Right.
Right. That's how we get to the Vega and Sagat funhouse.
That would have been like, well, is the prostitute thing over now?
Can we still
like
fuck
that
those chicks?
You did offer that to me.
Yeah, is that still on the table or what? I don't know how to read this Nerf gun attack.
Well, I guess the Nerf gun thing is to make it more kid friendly and like we don't want Ryu and Ken actually dealing guns.
No, I guess not. Whatever. But like, you're totally right about this family friendly thing though, because when those Nerf balls are hitting their foreheads, the score's like.
There's actually apparently I read it in today's edition of the IMDb Tribune.
Yeah.
There's a Goofy laugh in this. Like, and by that I mean like the laugh that Goofy does. Yup.
Oh, really? I watch a lot of Mickey Mouse Clubhouse.
Oh, no, I'm sorry, not the laugh, the howl that goes, Yahoo! That thing?
Oh,
Yahoo!
That's like the new Wilhelm scream.
I guess so. It's in this movie with human actors, which is
someone who says that. Ken.
It just says somewhere. Blah blah blah. Some scene.
I have to watch this movie all over again.
That's not gonna happen.
I'm sure like a truck crashes or something.
It might be like when someone's just getting thrown somewhere.
That is so stupid.
Guile and his two assistants. Kylie Minogue is Cammy. And some guy is T-Hawk. T-Hawk, by the way, looks like he got his name in an office Super Bowl pool and not from, like, being T-Hawk. A big badass, like, Native American fighter. This guy's
he
just
was
like
a quarterback in high school.
T-Hawk's real name is Ken Johnson.
Hey, man, that's the T-Hawk over there, man.
T-Hawk!
he's just so scrawny and, like, whatever.
He gave a lot of wet willies and fucking noogies.
So they come up with this plan where they're going to use Ken and Ryu to get into Sagat's operation because he's selling guns to Bison, and when that happens, blah, 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 we'll find out where Bison's base is, although that should be so easy to find.
He's like the head of the government,
yeah,
right?
It's the only mansion in Chateauloo, baby. Look for the biggest house and nuke it.
Look for the skeleton house.
Yeah. Yes, also look for
for Castle Grayskull and you'll find it.
The house with the best view of the mall.
So there's this Guile dies at this point. He gets shot like this.
Oh, squibs. Yeah. He's pulling a real Jim Gordon here.
Yeah.
Yeah. It was just pig's blood.
Which is so stupid because when you look at like how Van Damme explains this whole thing, like he sits up in the morgue and there's like a scare gag. But like he opens his jacket and like he's not wearing a bulletproof vest. He's just got like packets on his lower abdomen. If these people just aimed higher, this dude's iced.
But also, the funny thing is, Chun-Li like breaks into the facility and finds this out. Guile's just been chilling out in the morgue for like 4 hours, I guess.
He's really keeping up this act.
I guess I'll just stay here till everyone else goes home.
Well, to pass the time, I'll defile some bodies.
What if they would have shot me in the face?
Where's your fucking fake blood packet if you got a headshot?
What, was it Blanks or something?
No, it was Blanks. That's the thing.
Blankas.
Wait, who shot him?
Ken does.
Oh, I thought just some random Chateauloian.
No, because
I wish.
Did you watch the movie?
Sort of.
Other soldiers are about to fire, and then T-Hawk goes, "No, you'll hit the colonel." The colonel.
He said the captain, and they're like, "Cut!" No, it's a colonel, T-Hawk. It's a colonel. You're the captain.
Jim Gaffigan is Colonel Guile.
That'd be a better movie.
This is a family pack, and this is a family pack, and I'm getting paid for this, and this is a family pack.
Man, those Colonel Sanders commercials are in fucking infuriating.
So
I loved Norm. Norm was the best colonel.
He was. I don't know why he didn't get that kid
they
permanently.
Well,
that's the gag is we're like rotating.
They started with Daryl Hammond. Okay. Right?
Yes, Daryl Hammond was the first. Mm-hmm. He was the first to go.
I'm available.
Wait, no, the real colonel was the first to go.
I mean, I guess he's the only one that's actually technically went. He's been dead for decades.
Ooh, George Went? That'd be a great next colonel.
That would be terrific. That'll show you what happens if you have too much.
So we go to...
looks like I was getting high on my own supply. Now I'm obese.
Real quick, at this point, before Chun-Li breaks in, she's in the van with the Honda and Balrog. And
her camera operators.
Yeah. This is the first introduction to the word bro that society has ever seen.
Oh, you think
she's broing everybody. She's like, bro, out of the way. Move it, bro. She's like a Jersey guy. She's like, bro, move, bro.
That's Ming-Na as Chun-Li. She's okay in this.
She's most recently on that Agents of S.H.I.E.L.D., which I don't watch.
No, yeah, you would have to tie me to a chair and beat me with wet Bibles for me to care about that show. So that's just...
I watched the first season, and then I watched the season premiere of the second season, and I went, there's life out there somewhere. And I tuned out. That's what I did. I tuned right out.
Oh, life found a way, huh?
She has a good... She's got a good like a terrorist attack in this movie.
Oh yeah, she's
when is this? Are we up to this point? Yeah, basically jumping the gun.
No, she finds out that
it's fine. Even if you were,
she finds out that Guile is alive and that Ken and Ryu are in on it. And then she goes to this secret club where Sagat and Bison are.
Right, where Bison's getting all of like his illegal weapon shipments and whatnot. And then like oh god, this is where like Ken and Ryu are divided amongst the good guys and the bad guys.
Yep.
And there's a little
called
bit
very
of,
specifically good guys and bad guys.
And there's a little bit of comedy, and then oh, what's that noise coming from that closet? Oh, it's a TV broadcasting live, and it's Chun-Li, E Honda, and Balrog.
Yeah.
And Chun-Li's just like, I'm going to blow you all up because I'm a terrorist.
Yeah, and I mean, then, it is kind of a suicide bomb. Like, they drive a truck full
right,
of weapons
yeah.
into this little area.
It's weird. She's got like.
Do you think? And here's the thing, though. Do you think Honda and Balrog were aware of the situation at this point?
They're in on it because basically, they you find out that Bison killed her father, but
yes.
also quote unquote
that happened.
Yeah,
yeah.
Did you watch this movie?
No.
Well, that's the
hey. In Vin's defense, I did not spot that either.
Well, that's what that's. It's the scene
I was
where
watching the Northern Ireland.
It's where, like, Raul Julia as Bison has, like, the best line of the movie because she's talking about how, like, first of all, he kidnaps her, dresses her sexily.
Which is just her Street Fighter outfit. But yeah.
Right.
Alternate colors.
And then it's a weird, like.
Alternate color, you're right.
It's a weird, like, you know, you might be my girlfriend after all is over here. You know, like that. He's kind of setting that up again like a Bond villain. And she says, like, by the way. Do you remember like 10 years ago, like you rolled into my village
That's
and you murdered
right.
my father Word. And I'll never forget it. And what fucking Bison says is like, oh, for right. you, that was the worst day of your life. But for me, it was just Tuesday.
Yes. Yes.
And she fucking loses it and starts beating the shit out of him. And it's awesome.
That's when I started identifying with M. Bison. But also when that truck's rolling towards the that structure, I guess it's a tent.
Yeah, it's like a tent.
It's carnival.
This is where we get the one of the biggest moments of comedy in the film.
Oh,
guys.
Please.
Oh,
my
shit.
God. You know, so they're all watching the terrorist broadcast by Chun-Li. I mean, say what you will about M. Bison. He's the legitimate head of government.
He has bison bucks at this point.
Bison bucks, man, which are worth as much as £5. After he's like, he assures Sagat that they will be worth that much after he kidnaps their queen.
Oh, I honestly think that Raul Julia is kind of great in this movie. I think he's very funny.
It
like
is,
he kind of gets
fun.
It. Like
it's
his lines.
Raul Julia was an amazing actor, and I'll tell you what, he knows exactly where he is in this movie.
Mm-hmm. He's like, once I kidnap their queen, and like, the guy's like, oh man, like,
that is the movie I want. Just M. Bison taking that old biddy out of Buckingham. That is what I want,
dude. But that's the movie. That's a real fucking London Has Fallen right there.
I would love London Has Fallen, but it's M. Bison doing it all.
It might as well be M. Bison, in case you're wondering. If you watch London Has Fallen,
Chandelou is also known as Fuckheadistan, I think.
Yes, exactly.
But the big moment of comedy I was talking about. Now,
oh,
the
yes.
truck is careening towards this circus tent, and everyone's watching the TV, and Zangief says, "Change the channel."
Yeah.
That is the big moment of that is the biggest comedy line of the film.
What do you think Zangief was hoping was also on the air at the same time?
Looney Tunes?
Yes, yeah, I could see that. Yeah. That should be a thing because he's supposed to be like a big idiot in this movie. Cut to him like eating cereal and watching cartoons. That would be a good gag.
But after Sagat gets burned by the Bison's bucks before the truck rolls by, Sagat clearly has a word a day calendar because he goes, "This conclave is over," which is a secret meeting, but you would never say the word conclave.
No, not in Street Fighter the movie.
That's a thesaurus situation.
Well, now, if they had to have Nerf guns for the children, they need a conclave for
for the grown-ups.
The adults.
But also, you find out that both Balrog and E. Honda were disgraced by M. Bison? Question mark.
What?
That's racism?
I don't know. No. They say, like, oh, yeah. She's like, oh, he killed my father. And then, like, Balrog's like, yeah. E. Honda's like, yeah. He's like, oh, you're the best sumo in the world. He's like, I was until M. Bison used information to disgrace me. And then Balrog comes out of nowhere. He's like, he did the same to my boxing career.
Oh, yeah.
And I'm like, what are you talking about?
What were these? Oh, you know what I just thought of?
Uh-huh.
sex tourism.
Oh, yeah, that's why
he's got some candid camera. Speaking of America's Funniest Home Videos, he's got some candid camera of E. Honda and Balrog doing unconscionable things in Chandelou City.
And you know, that's
outlaw burb, man.
It's their own fault. That's the thing. Yeah, that's the thing.
It's really their own.
Sorry, you're such a fucking pervert, E. Honda.
Exactly. Their own sin brought them down.
You know what, Balrog? The fucking chicken came home to roost, and you can't box anymore.
Now you're just a professional cameraman.
speaking of them and their perversions, they're at one point captured by this opposition force.
Uh-huh. Yes.
And there's a dude, there's like a big, Fall Frungren smacking him.
Yeah.
trying to break E. Honda. It doesn't work.
Oh, well, this is great. I was like, is he just so fat that he doesn't feel pain?
That's
you know?
I was thinking, too.
But he claims it's something like with the sumo
He's
teachings.
Got the force.
Yeah, pretty much.
I thought
he
it
takes
was
his mind someplace else.
The layers of blubber, like over blubber, right? Like, yeah. it's like hardens like a good pelt of an animal or something. But it turns out he was like using like he was thinking he wasn't there.
Yeah, going somewhere else. He's going to his happy place.
Right. Batmanish, which
using
is good.
The force. Yeah.
And then the guy steps out for a minute to take a piss. And Balrog's like, "Yo, E. Honda, give me a hand."
Oh yeah, I love
and
this.
And then E. Honda says, "Hey dude, we've been in prison for 2 hours. Try me in a month."
Yeah.
As in, I will jerk you off and or have sex with you in a month's
in
time.
In 30 days.
Which, by the way, that's a much bigger joke than change the channel.
Well, here's the thing.
Balrog and E. Honda in 30 days and 30 nights? Oh, those hot summer nights.
Well, the thing is, like, that's a joke that, like, I'm watching it now and I'm just, like, barfing in my living room. But as a kid, I didn't really pick up on it.
I didn't get it, yeah.
Or, you know, but... Yeah. Change the channel is a joke that everyone can enjoy.
That's for the kids.
Jerk me off in jail. it's a little bit of a different kind of
That's
joke.
That's for the adults. A little something for the dads.
Yeah, you know, when all those dads are sitting there like, "God damn, I'm taking my kid to see this Street Fighter movie. What's that jerking off?"
Hey, he's going to jerk him off in jail. A fat one's going to jerk him off in jail. Like, oh my God, Dad.
So, Dad, why did you laugh so much at that jail joke?
He jerked him off in jail, and he's fucking fat.
I love it.
Man, now I'm just picturing your dad taking you to see this movie, Steve.
That's what happened.
This is what happened.
Oh, whatever. So
there's a great moment. So this is kind of around the time when they're planning this covert operation where Guile is going to take a stealth boat and ram it up Chandelou's ass. Like ram
That's
up
a great line. I'm sorry.
The Bisonopolis' ass.
We're going to use this stealth boat. And by the way, an air attack is impossible. You hear a very distinct, aw.
Yes, you totally do. That was one of the pilots, one of the AN pilots.
I'm an air guy.
Nah, boats. It's boats this time.
But why would that be impossible?
It makes no sense.
I guess because they want to rescue people. I say fucking liquidate the place.
Oh, exactly. Yeah. Again, it's like total tops 60 people, he's saying, which is an overestimation.
That is an acceptable loss.
19. 19 civilians.
But so he's plotting this whole thing to ram this stealth boat into the, you know, Bisonopolis or whatever. And the dude who's the bad guy in Ace Ventura 2 shows up in this
Simon
movie.
Simon Callow.
Yes. And he shows up and he's like, "By the way, Mr. Ventura,
the lights, the ones behind you."
You know what,
best
man?
Part of
flip Maybe, it, quick.
He's the guy from Amadeus to me because I have culture.
Yeah, yeah. Nice guy. I could give a flying fuck about the movie Amadeus.
It's a good movie.
I don't care for that movie in the slightest. I'll tell you what, though.
Wow.
He's in this movie, and he's telling Guile that he's got to, like, quit the armed forces. Jean-Claude Van Damme goes up to the microphone. He's like, "The war is canceled." The war is canceled.
Well, he's like, "Oh, well, we've reached a diplomatic solution." And he's like, "Oh, okay. I'll just tell all these people to go home then. Hey, everybody, we can go home. Oh, it's okay. Just go home." And it's like, he's like being a dick about it.
He motivates this army of soldiers by being sarcastic.
It's been it's the really only does. Time. It's the only time in military history that that's happened.
Oh, and I guess the ambassador is going to shit on your children's mouth, but we get to go home. but the problem is he's in Simon Callow is in Amadeus, but now he has to like basically set up alley oops for Van Damme to dunk.
Oh yeah,
he's basically like, oh. Have you lost your mind?
Time
like,
to clock out, everybody. We get to go home.
You lost your mind? No, but you lost your balls.
Oh, yeah, that's what he says to him. But you lost your balls.
Like, oh, I worked with whatever the fuck that guy is.
Tom Hulse?
Jim Carrey?
He had not worked with Jim Carrey yet.
Abraham.
Oh, right, of course.
Yeah.
Flip it quick.
So then,
sorry,
Guile.
On these rhinos.
Man, you guys have watched Ace Ventura 2 When Nature Calls way more than
dude,
I have.
I've seen that movie. It's got it's problematic.
Oh sure.
The race stuff in that movie. Oh, sure. Go back and watching it now with educated eyes of an enlightened society. How did that get me?
Oh, I don't know. It's tough, but I'll tell you what. I've seen that movie no less than 30 times, and I've seen the first Ace Ventura total tops maybe 7 times.
Wow.
I'll tell you what. It was one of those things where it was a rainy vacation, and it was somehow the only VHS tape we had with us. So it was a lot of back-to-back Ace Ventura 2.
I love them both.
Guano?
Oh.
Right? It's a bad shit?
Why isn't Jim Carrey in this movie? He could have played like Blanca. Jim Carrey is Blanca. Ooh. Better movie.
Yeah, totally. Would have set him up nicely to play the Riddler a few years later.
Hold on a second. Maybe Jim Carrey is everyone in like a one-man show?
No, that's Chewbacca's beat.
Oh, all right. Well, maybe once Chewbacca's done with it and it's such a success, he can hand it off to Jim Carrey.
Oh, right. When like, he sweeps all the Tonys?
Yeah. Yeah.
Like Lin-Manuel Miranda stepping down from Hamilton?
Exactly.
We're going to get Jim Carrey to replace him. Also, this stealth boat looks like garbage.
Horrible.
It's just a
boat.
It's just a black boat with a bunch of gray spray painted cardboard
and
all over.
It just says Colonel William Guile on
Why
the
is his name on the side of the boat?
That's
the boat.
That's not how stealth works.
You don't sign your stealth boat, my friend.
Well, it's more stealth, what with the not being on radar.
Yeah, but
whatnot.
Still, like if it's sunk or exploded, like it is,
right.
You could easily track who was there.
Yeah.
Like it's just the dumbest.
It's not like it's a sub or it's like an aircraft carrier that you have to name it after somebody. This is a stealth operation. You're not naming it the USS Colonel Guile.
Yeah, it doesn't need a christening.
No.
I christen this boat for me. It's also not named after the guy driving it.
No. It'd be like the Thomas Jefferson or something.
Thomas Jefferson never drove a boat. There's plenty of boats.
Well, but he was renowned for his stealth activities. If you look at his family chart.
This part of the movie has one of my favorite parts.
Oh, please.
Guile's driving the USS Guile to take out
I'm
a bison.
I'm driving the meat to you, bison.
And he pops out a VHS tape.
Oh, my God.
I don't even know it's a VHS tape. It's like he throws
it in.
Thing. Yeah. And he throws it in, and it's a vacation of him and Blanca. And he's talking to the camera. He's like, no, take the camera away. And then he's watching this as he's going to attack Bison.
Well, he's trying to get revved up because, you know.
This is not Hearts on Fire.
This is not, it's Blanca. You can't win.
You can't win. We have a house. We have a car. We have money.
It's Van Damme and Blanca on the beach running.
I'm afraid, all right?
Man,
all right,
is that
Blanca.
For the first time in my life, I'm afraid.
You ring the bell, Blanca. Ding.
Wait, so in this video that's a flashback, he's a monster already?
No. Yeah, well, yeah, maybe that would make more sense.
Me and Charlie on vacation.
Oh, but my favorite credit in the film.
The truth about Charlie. He's a Blanca.
The last two actors credited in the movie are these two women that are just credited under one heading, which is Guile and Blanca's dates.
Oh, from the video?
Yeah,
oh,
dude.
Man.
Which is kind of... Because now I'm imagining...
Dude, tentacles get involved in this video, man?
But the thing is, like, if I'm, you know, let's say my name is whatever, and I'm like...
Hi, whatever.
You can Bravo. Use, you can,
yeah. Good improv. Good yes and. Yeah.
It is pretty good.
No, so this actress has to go, like, you're going to put that, it's a major motion picture, you're going to put on your resume.
Well, it's a motion picture.
You're going to put it on your resume. Do you, like, call yourself Kyle and Blanca's date? Do you
Kyle wasn't in the movie.
Or Guile and Blanca's date? Do you call yourself Guile and Blanca's date number one? Do you call yourself...
Get out of here, Kyle. I'm cutting in.
Well, you're acting like these women had a say in that.
Well, here's the thing is you're playing Jean-Claude Van Damme's date in 1994. Yeah, I'm putting that on my resume.
Well, no, exactly, but nobody wants to be Blanca's date. You know what I mean? Like, but I feel like people were the both of them who are credited as this duo act.
Oh, I see.
There
what you're
is worse shit to be than Blanca's date.
Yeah, but you're not even really Blanca's date. You're pre-Blanca's date.
Yeah, you're Charlie's date.
You're Charlie Blanca's date.
Yeah, it's just a chuck fuck at that point.
So around here is where M. Bison gasses all of them.
Yeah,
they all sneak into Castle Bison Skull. And he like lures them into this room. And
he's about to fuck Chun-Li, and Chun-Li's actually about to kill him because he's beating the shit out of him.
They blow it up.
He's about to what, Chun-Li?
Well, what did I say?
Oh, you said the F word. Oh.
Yeah, he's trying to fuck her.
Is he?
Yes.
All right. I wasn't watching the movie.
My God in heaven.
Well, actually...
My God in himmel.
Here's my thing. Because I called Ken and Ryu Han Solo and I got shit. There's a scene where they're more close to a Lando Calrissian because when they break in to save
Ihan... You know, Ken, you belong up here with amongst the clouds.
No, when they're saving...
How you doing, Ryu?
When they're saving Balrog and Ihanda... They both choke him. It's kind of a double Lando Calrissian. They go, there's still a chance to save Han. Still a chance to save E. Honda.
You're totally right.
Yeah, you're right.
That's what happens.
But so, yeah, like Chun-Li is about to murder him. Like, it's right there. Like, if this game had fatalities, like, finish him is coming up.
She should have done the super kick, by the way.
This is where you're going to do it. And so she doesn't do that, but she beats the shit out of him. And then, like, they're, like, knocking on the door.
It's like, shut up, you idiots. I'm about to save the movie.
Exactly. So then, like, Bison sort of, like, gets up and traps them in the room. And then all this gas is
coming. He's got a panic room, man.
He does. It's like a push the button and the fucking steel door comes down.
And then Forrest Whitaker's breaking into his house.
Shoots Dwight Yoakam in the face. Dude, that's a big mess to clean up at the end of that movie.
Oh, sure.
Oh, no, I think he gets a sledgehammer to the head.
I don't remember.
I think it's a sledgehammer to the head.
Yes.
Was Gallagher in this movie?
Gonna get you now, Dwight Yoakam, you son of a bitch. Get over here. Oh, we're gonna rob this rich lady.
I could be in a David Fincher movie, Mark.
I could be in an Oscar-nominated feature film, Mark.
I could play the Winklevoss twins, Mark.
We row crew kasplat.
I think that would be a pretty good movie.
I can terrorize a 12-year-old Kristen Stewart, Mark. Get over here, you tiny son of a bitch.
No, that's why Jared Leto gets shot in the head.
Oh, right.
Which is,
I listen to 30 Seconds to Mars, Mark.
It's one of my fantasies.
I wanted to destroy something beautiful, Mark. I could be in Fight Club, Mark.
I could do what Helena Bonham Carter does, Mark.
I could steal laundry, Mark.
Oh, what?
Oh, mercy. Yeah, so they all get gassed, and it's this hilarious thing where, like, E. Honda's trying to, like, ram through this door, and this guy does a real, like, Power Rangers bulking skull fall over a table.
There's nothing more embarrassing, unless you're on the 1960s Batman show, than passing out from gas. Dalsim starts giving Blanca some of the good juju.
Oh, yeah.
Because,
yeah.
like, he's getting all
he's
this...
He's showing them that video that fucking Guile has in his covert boat.
He hacked the feed, you think?
Yeah.
No,
he's so like, remember that vacation?
Man, that sweet vacation that everybody's remembering.
Me and Blanca went to Sandals 1 year. It was beautiful. We got all sorts of babes. We gambled.
Buffets as far as the eye can see.
We went in a heart-shaped jacuzzi.
It's okay. It's just Blanca.
Beautiful Mount Everest.
There's, I got to point it out before we get away from this gassing scene, because it's like they all... E Honda falls through a table. The rest of them are like all passed out. And Bison starts laughing.
Oh, yeah.
And there's this amazing shot of Raul Julia like, ah, ha, ha, ha. And there's like a light flash, and it's definitely a skeleton.
Mm-hmm.
It's dissolving, and there's a fucking skeleton.
He's got a skeleton fireplace in the room that kind of superimposed it on his face.
It's exactly what's going on,
it's
man.
It's pretty great.
Boy, do I get it, Stephen E. D'Souza.
But this guard who's guarding Dalsim and Blanca is
Ron
like,
Jeremy.
Yeah, he looks exactly like
oh
Ron
my
Jeremy.
God. This fucking pig shit. So like he's like trying to change Blanca by showing him like birds
vacation videos
and flowers and and
baby
and
stuff.
Weddings.
MLK.
It's a bunch of like
the weddings. It was a wedding, right?
I wanted to know whose wedding this was. Where are you getting this fucking footage?
Also,
scene?
Like the whole plot of the Clockwork Orange thing. Like we're gonna show him Hitler,
yeah,
nonstop, and then suddenly he's gonna be sympathetic to M. Bison. I don't see that correlation. I think Blanca could usurp him, maybe.
I do think this is the least plausible progress bar in history, though.
Oh, yeah, you're right.
And then there's been quite a few implausible progress bars, but it's like it's a red one, and it's like when Blanca's brain is going evil, it's like 49%, and Dalsim gets in there. And it starts to go blue because it knows that he's becoming good?
It doesn't make any sense.
Okay.
And why does that percentage number stay the same?
Yeah.
Well, that's like all. It's like the body mass thing, too.
Yes.
It's
yeah.
like the little computer is like, body mass increase by 47%.
Which is a marked thing. You could when you get fatter, your body mass, you get bulkier.
Sure. Oh, I've got a progress bar.
That's not progress, my friend.
Ooh, good point. No wonder it's so low.
So, Dalsim does this thing, so he becomes good. The boat shows up. This is when M. Bison, speaking of Batman Forever, uses video games to destroy them or whatever.
Oh, man. He's
Am I the only one that loved this part?
Did you love it?
Oh, I loved every second of it. He's like, it's like I was like a frantic kid in an arcade. He's like, button, joystick.
Well, see, that's the thing. M. Bison's a real button masher, and I don't appreciate
that. He's a button
that.
Masher.
That's some cheap shit right there.
Loved it.
But that's, I mean, I feel like that's in another... Maybe I'm just thinking about how they operate the Statue of Liberty in Ghostbusters 2, which is fucking stupid.
Oh, with the Nintendo controllers? Yeah.
Yeah, but is there not
and a
another...
a lot of slime
Well,
news?
All the slime, of course.
Could use some slime news.
Oh, sure. Is there not another video game adaptation where someone is indeed playing a video game?
I think
like,
it's
in
Mario
it?
Brothers, or am I making that up?
I feel like it might be like Dennis like Hopper's laughing and doing something.
You might be making that up.
It's entirely possible.
Absolutely.
I
just kind of say stuff.
But yeah, he mashes all these buttons and like blows up the stealth boat. They somehow jump out of it. You don't see that happening.
You don't see that happen at all.
There's a throwaway line where Van Damme's like, we better go for a swim before they make us go for a swim.
You see him unbuckle his seatbelt.
Takes out that VHS tape.
Yeah.
I'm not going to lose my date.
Memories are forever.
And then that's it. It blows up.
I don't want to lose the part where we go to Coldstone together. And they sang us the songs.
Coldstone Creamery?
Yeah, of course.
Man, let me tell you.
Mash some Snickers in there, mon ami.
My friend Blanca loves a Snicker bar.
Dude, the fact that those poor bastards
are
instructed by a corporate office to fucking sing a jingle every time someone puts change in a tip jar. Oh, they are the greatest of heroes.
Wow,
because
I did not know that. I guess I never tipped them.
You're doing them a favor, honestly.
Like, they're like, please don't tip. Please don't put that dollar in here.
Ooh, there's duct tape over this tip jar.
It's so humiliating for these people.
You know what? Fuck that chain.
You know,
I'll say it. I'll say it.
You know who sings for quarters? Homeless people.
Do you think really? Guile, not for me.
You think Guile told the waiter that it was Blanca's birthday?
Oh, it's your birthday, Blanca. You get an extra cigar.
It'll be fun. Kiss, kiss.
I just think of going over to the waiter, like when he's like, I have to use the bathroom.
He's like, you see the guy at the end? That's his birthday today.
And by birthday, I mean last day when he's not a monster.
If you do not bring him a piece of cake, I will punch you.
Oh, wait a second. His last day before he's a monster. Are you saying they went directly from sandals to this operation?
Absolutely. Yep. And then he gets kidnapped.
They got called in.
And then he's like, oh, no, Charlie, I come for you, buddy. I will continue the vacation, I promise.
Sorry, babes. We have to go. Work calls. We have to get to Shadaloo.
Sorry, babe number one and babe number two.
I'm sure your career will do very well.
We got to go.
I think it was... Laura Linney and...
What?
I hate you.
No, I'm making that up.
Oh, good.
Uh-huh.
So they got M. Bison riding around in this, like, fucking cherry picker device.
This is stupid as
it's
anything.
It's so stupid that he's flying around in this thing.
And it doesn't really work. And I mean, like, so basically... You know, Bison is under siege from whatever, like all of the...
Well, the AN soldiers. I feel like there's additional AN soldiers that have nothing to do with, like, Guile's operation. Like, the dude from Ace Ventura 2 was like, better send more people in there just to be safe, Mr. Ventura.
Well, he's as bad as M. Bison at this point, Guile is, because he's got a rogue force. This is a militia.
Oh, yeah, because Guile's technically been fired at this point.
Yes, and the AN had wanted to negotiate.
Well, he brings up a good point.
Okay.
And he says, if it's $20 billion today, what's to say it's not $50 billion tomorrow?
That's
which
true.
Which is a very good point.
That's true. So that's why you just got to kill it.
Just got to kill him.
Shoot him in the fucking
head. Got to sonic boom the shit out of that guy.
I wish.
Oh, that would be the line, right? Like, he would, like, cock his gun, blow, like, say sonic boom and blow his head off.
That'd be
with
awesome.
A real gun.
Sonic boom.
Yeah. Boom, boom. And then, like, the blood spews out the back of his head. That
absolutely.
Little, that hat spins around again.
Let me tell you. Speaking of.
I love that. I love when his hat spins around.
Speaking of public execution, my favorite part of this movie is when Van Damme gets into this laboratory and sees what they've done to his buddy.
Oh my god, it's so good.
And he is totally prepared to execute Blanca point blank.
I was kind of on the same page.
He's like, I will avenge you, mon ami.
Do me one favor. If you ever see me and I've been turned into a monster, you're all my very good friends. I would ask you to give me a week. You know what? Let's just see. Maybe give me some juice.
Okay, Steve, I'll check in with you next week.
Yeah, maybe a lot of... it's bullshit.
It science. Might wear off. Who it knows?
You know what I mean? Like, yeah.
We don't know how this is going to pan out.
Give me a week. Let's go all to right. some doctors. Then blow my brains yeah. out if you want to.
X-Men The Last Stand taught us that a big pandemic could always just wear off.
I'll take 48 true. Hours.
Yeah, just
I need a week.
Before you execute.
Yeah, just give me a minute.
And what's awesome is Blanca's reaction is like, oh, well, I... Okay. Like, if you must execute me, like, my best friend.
I guess so.
He's so quick to just murder his best friend. It's amazing.
And the actor with the most gravitas, Dalsim, is like, no, that would make you as bad as they are. And like goes on this yeah. whole fucking speech.
I starred in Gandhi, which this dude did.
He did.
Yeah, so he's not executed, which is nice for this radioactive monster, I suppose.
But, like, and then, like, Bison's like, DJ is like a hacker in this movie. DJ is played by the guy who was
in Juana Man.
He's Juana Man.
Yes.
Juana Man, and he's in Friday the 13th 6 playing Demon, the biker who gets murdered in the outhouse.
So he checks the balance.
Ooh, baby.
He checks. and sees that
he ate a lot of Mexican, right?
He's farting up.
He has some line about like enchiladas something.
He gets stabbed in the head in an outhouse, right?
It's through his like stomach chest area.
It's pretty great.
That's how I want to go.
I mean, honestly, there's been some shits I've taken. I wish Jason Voorhees just finished me off.
Or a T-Rex.
Oh man, yeah, that
death ever.
I side with that Italian lawyer sometimes. Oh, I'm like, you know what, T-Rex? Now's the time.
That is a good point.
So no, but Bison finds out that he didn't get paid the money he was owed, so he's gonna kill these things. He's like, oh, all right, send out my minion Blanca to kill them. And like before, and he's doing this on like national TV. Like before that happens, man, you gotta get a status report. Like the day, before you go live, like, hey, is Blanca all ready to go?
Is my Blanca complete?
Listen, what you got to do if you're cooking up a Blanca, like, sick it on a cow or a dog.
Yeah, good point. What happened to the goat?
Yeah, speaking of fucking Jurassic Park, exactly
a
right.
Goat, yes. You know, he doesn't want to be fed. He wants to hunt.
Man, Sam Neill hunting Blanca?
Also, though, I mean.
I like it.
It's all
wait,
on.
That's how you do a Street Fighter, man. Blanca's loose.
Don't move. Blanca can't see you if you don't move.
And then Sam Neill's like, wait a minute, we can make a good buck here. Wraps him up in some rope, right? Ships him off to this international competition where it's like a blood sport.
Oh, I see.
Now he's got his monster in the bet, you know?
Oh, he's making millions.
Oh, yeah, he's putting big money on Blanca, you know? Oh, yeah, he's from Brazil. That's why it looks like that. Yeah, he loved Carnival. The paint just stuck. Stuck?
Yeah, it's stuck.
Stuck. I've had a few libations tonight.
That's all right. These things happen. But yeah, you're totally right. Test out. And here's the thing. It's all on M. Bison because you kind of have a feeling that Dhalsim is like a little wishy-washy as far as your evil plan.
Yeah.
Don't make Dhalsim the head engineer of this fucking Blanca project. You're leaving him alone with this thing the whole time. There's one security
guard. No, Ron Jeremy was there.
Yeah. Oh, right. The hedgehog was in attendance. I forgot.
And by the way, he DJ, check to see if they gave us the money. It's like, man, it's like the cheesiest, like zero balance. Oh, yeah. I was like, I know that feeling.
Check and see if they've dumped the money into my Swiss bank account.
Yes, he does say Swiss.
What? An overdraft fee? DJ, how is it negative $30?
Oh, no, I get paid on Thursday this pay period.
The Swiss bank is denying my godhood?
Looks like someone got my debit card number. I haven't been at a 7-Eleven in Milwaukee.
Yes, Swiss Bank. That wasn't me.
But yeah, like he's acted like fucking Blanca's hype man. Like he's going to drop the hottest shit in the world.
Yeah.
And then he's a wet fart and nothing happens.
Yeah.
Well, what happens is fucking Guile comes out with a super kick and starts fighting him.
Yeah, but not his super kick.
Yeah, yeah.
Also,
it's actually a stolen Liu Kang kick.
Good point.
He does do a flash kick later in the movie.
And it's almost like M. Bison's at the end of the screen and he can't go anywhere. And he cheeses him twice with it.
He totally cheeses him moment.
Hits him with
but
it twice.
That kick is bullshit because he jumps out of this little containment unit going full speed. You need the momentum to run up to that.
Yeah.
Yeah.
In my professional opinion.
It's one of the problems with this movie is they want to try to base it in reality and make it this like weird, you know, like political action thriller or whatever.
Is that what this was?
I thought it was
a 90s comedy.
They want it to be that. Okay. But there's also like dabbling in magic.
Oh, ho, my pelican brief.
On the 3 days of Blanca. Man, that's a great movie. Blanca like returns home to his townhouse and everybody's been murdered.
Oh yeah.
And it's like, oh no, I thought this was the safe house. And then he's the
like
only member
fighting the mailman.
He's the only member of the team left. Yeah.
Yeah.
That's a good movie.
By the way, in case anyone was wondering, Blanca's real name was actually Jimmy first in the game.
What? No, no one cared.
I did. I'm very actually happy that I know that now.
At the end of the game, his mother would come out and go, Jimmy, and she'd hug him.
Really?
Yeah, if you beat the game as Blanca.
Why would I do that?
Great point.
Well, the electric stuff is kind of cool. Yeah.
Why doesn't he get electric power? Come on.
He doesn't get down and start
That's
shaking.
All
none of that.
I need.
It's
That's
so,
all.
It's so stupid.
Because and the problem with this movie is finally now in the last act, we start getting some street fighting going on.
Now right. We're getting some fighting, yeah.
Because it's Guile versus M. Bison. Sure. E-Honda fights Zangief.
I love that because they suddenly fall into like a hole in the floor that seems to go to another dimension.
That hole is horrible. That hole is horrible.
I know. They like it sends them into, I guess, what's the model of the future mall.
Which, did you catch this fucking Godzilla joke? Yeah.
How could you not?
It's like a frying pan over the head. Of how they hit you with this fucking
Because
Godzilla
how could you not? Here's how you could not. Because this is the kind
You're
of movie...
You're watching the Northern Ireland game while this is going on?
Most definitely. Also, this is the kind of movie where when you have to get up to go to the bathroom, you're not pausing it.
Oh, no way.
You're
no.
like, just let it roll. I gotta take a shit, let it roll.
In fact, so many things during this movie, it's kind of funny.
I will find out extra stuff to do in the bathroom during this movie.
Oh, you can figure it out. You stay in there long enough.
I'll Google Blanca in the shower.
Eric, you know what? Give me a month and then we'll talk.
But Captain Sawada, who's like Guile's number three or something.
God, this dude is barely a fucking character.
Who gives a shit?
He's actually the number four because you have T-Hawk and Cammy.
Yes, by Kylie Minogue.
Right, so that's two number twos.
That's a good point.
It's a tie. And then Captain Sawada, who... is dubbed really poorly.
Oh,
it's
so
like, hi, I'm Colonel Guile. It's like, yuck.
You're doing justice. I mean, it's like, this dude's mouth is not moving, and he's saying all sorts of sentences.
I think I'd rather have that for Jean-Claude Van Damme, though.
Yes, absolutely. Exactly. Get that dude in there.
And Jean-Claude Van Damme as dubbed by Bill Paxton.
I can see that. You get Welker in there, man.
Oh, Welker could do a mean Jean-Claude Van Damme impression.
Just do, like, have Frank Welker just do Freddy from Scooby-Doo.
Well, hey, gang.
Hey, gang. It looks like we got some street fighting to do.
Sonic Boom. Oh, no, my good friend Blanca.
Charlie.
So, yeah, everybody's fighting. You get the bad
street fighting.
Street fighting, finally.
G7.
You get the first of two deaths of M. Bison at this point. Because he's thrown on like an electric console like Tommy Lee Jones in Under Siege.
Yeah.
And just fucking bites it. But then we learn that there's like the Bison life support suit.
Well, Jean-Claude Van Damme has a great line in this where he look Cammy like connects to him and she's like, "How are you?" He's like, "Almost dead." And he's like,
he says, half dead.
Half dead, half
right?
dead.
Because it's
yes,
like,
thank
oh,
you.
Now I'm thinking about the status bar.
Yes, yes. And then she goes, "And Bison, fully dead."
Oh, yeah.
Fully dead, man. Nice.
But he was fucking wrong because that fucking Nazi uniform he's wearing has like a life support system, so it gives him CPR and it does like the shock paddles.
Yeah,
it brings him back to
all
life.
In secret.
And finally, all the kids at home get exactly what they wanted, which is
M. Bison.
Yeah, Jean-Claude Van Damme, the top of his game, and Raul Julia struggling with stomach cancer, finally get to go mano a mano.
Yeah, well, you know, this is where M. Bison levitates and has, like, the shock gauntlet and
that's kind of, you know what, finally someone's doing something that looks
well,
like it might be from the game.
It's something from the game, right? He's levitating, he's doing the fucking shocker.
He's doing the shocker
that we all know and love.
Almost does the psycho crusher, which I appreciate.
Yep.
It's all there in the last 10 minutes of this
And he's
movie.
Wearing platform shoes, which is pretty cool.
Yeah, would you?
Love it.
Is this where he's got the monologue about lightning, though?
Oh, yeah. Well, no, he's all of a sudden, M. Bison at the end of this movie turns into a Satanist. He's like, "Well, you pray to your God, but I hailed Satan, and he gave me all this." And I'm like, "Whoa, what?"
He's what
like,
happened here?
The Church of Anton LaVey.
And my favorite line of the movie, which is maybe my favorite Raul Julia line ever, which is like, "And Satan fell from heaven like lightning."
It is pretty fantastic.
That should have made the Oscar montage. I'm not sure if it did.
Wow, that would have been disrespectful.
Kiss of the Spider Woman.
I mean, come on, this. Moon over Panador over this.
Probably.
Did he get acknowledged?
He had to have. That was a big death.
I thought Dennis Farina was a big death, and look what happened.
Yeah, you know what? I don't know. They probably didn't, just to fuck with us.
Like, oh, I'm sorry, he's Puerto Rican. Can't make the montage. My apologies.
But this is also where he's got, like, his, like, flying desk. Like, this whole thing is going on. He's kind of looking like fucking Dr. Wily from Sonic, floating around on this stupid-ass
thing.
From
Sonic? Isn't that Mega Man?
Yeah, you're thinking Dr. Robotnik.
Robotnik, excuse me.
You know what? Maybe I'm confused.
No, it's Dr. Robotnik is what I was thinking of. He flies around in the little cube.
Yeah, at the end when you're...
Or a little globe, you know? Right,
yeah. Sonic 2 with tails at the end.
Oh, my God.
Yes. Wily's got shit, too.
If when... Guile beats Bison and all these squirrels come out of that thing. Like, that would be...
It tallies up your coins.
Squirrels and chipmunks and birds fly out of this
little bunnies.
Oh, my God. I had no idea.
Dude, if you...
Bison, you maniac!
If you punch Jean-Claude Van Damme in the face and a bunch of rings fall all over the place, it'd be awesome. So what's great is, like, this whole, like, Super Bison thing doesn't last long because he, like... You know, gets his super boots punched through this like wall of TVs, and he's crushed by this whole thing. To where Jean-Claude Van Damme has the famous line, "Bison, you are off the air."
Well, he's got so many one-liners in this movie.
Oh, it yeah. Is. They're and trying they, to make all sorts of T-shirts out of this movie.
And they all suck.
They're all terrible.
They're fucking garbage.
I'm the Ripper Man, and you're out of business.
Boy, that sucks. Boy, that sucks.
And everybody else kind of stands around. Like, the Zangief-y Honda fight doesn't matter. We get a reprise of Ryu and Vega.
Sure.
Which is fun. Uh-huh. We do get a bullshit Hadouken, which I don't appreciate.
Yeah, because he does it, and he doesn't say it. If you're going to do it, just fucking say
and
it.
And I
just
don't see
it.
A fireball slowly move across the screen, which is what I need.
And you get the spinning uppercut at this point.
Yes, where...
They're fighting in a gym locker room for whatever the fuck reason.
There's a bunch of medicine balls all over the place.
Yeah.
I guess at some point Sagat gets a scar across his chest because at the end he takes his shirt off. That's where it's there.
Oh. Yeah. That wasn't just there the whole time?
Oh, maybe it was.
No, because it seemed bloody.
It does
seem fresh.
It's a fresh flesh wound.
Maybe reopened it.
Hold on. Let me Google Sagat in the shower.
Oh, that's there for sure. DJ's trying to escape with all this chest full of money.
Sure.
Sagat's like, oh, I'm going with you for some reason.
That's the dumbest. Like, Sagat grabs, like, the other side of this treasure chest, and he's like, you didn't say the magic word.
Yeah, and I mean, like, this dude could beat up that... This guy is, like, 68 years old. Sagat's not a tough guy in this movie.
But he was the former Iron Fist, and DJ is just a hacker in this movie.
That's true.
He's not a street fighter. The whole... Like, this whole thing, like, comes down and whatnot, and, you know...
Please tell me it's over.
T-Hawk and Cammy are, like, attacking the castle.
Yeah, we, like, raid this castle, and the thing that's crazy is it's like, all right... We got to get these hostages out of here. And all these, like, AN soldiers storm the compound and get... They're, like, supposed to be escorting these hostages out. If you look at what's going on with these extras, I don't think these extras playing the AN soldiers knew what their characters were doing in this part of the story because they are roughing up these hostages. Yes. They're, like, pushing them, and they're like, get the fuck out! Get the fuck out! They're, like, really, really roughing up these poor people.
That's what the UN did in Kosovo, my friends.
Oh, wow, this movie's really much more political than I thought it was.
Yeah, no, you know what? It's more accurate than you thought it was.
Mm-hmm.
Well, you know, I see these...
Oh,
like,
no, we better get the Street Fighters in there.
Oh, man, come on, Dalsim, you got to break it up.
You got to airdrop in some Street Fighters.
Every time I see these blue uniforms, I just think about Nick Nolte as the UN soldier in Hotel Rwanda.
Ah, God damn it. Oh, God damn it, Blanca, get the fuck back in the cage.
If you... Listen, find a way to wedge Nick Nolte into this movie. You could do it.
Oh, my God. He could have turned into Blanca in the Hulk movie when he bites that power cable.
Oh, God.
Ah, God damn it. I'm Blanca now. Now I'm Blanca. I'm fucking green. Keep hitting the punch button. I'm going to fucking turn into electricity. I thought I turned yellow first for alcoholism. I'm jaundiced.
Oh, whatever. There's a good... I like the Zangief line where he goes... DJ's like, oh, you know, we're the bad guys. And Zangief's like, oh, really? And he's like, Yeah, that's why, you know, and I got, that's why, why'd you do it then? Because I got paid all this money. He's like, you got paid?
Oh,
that's,
yeah.
A fun line.
Yeah, this dude's like totally flabbergasted by that.
Zangief is kind of the comic relief.
And then Dalsim and Blanca.
They go to on a boat together?
They just go on like a little corner and they spoon up as everything comes down.
Well, he's like, oh, but I thought, there's this like really stupid line where he's like, oh, why are you going? Also, like Dalsim, by the way. It's kind of Dalsim Begins because
yes, this is the origin.
You're totally right.
Get the drums going. Get the drums going.
It's been Rasa, Rasa. No, I don't know. Like the mutagen falls on his arm, which I guess we'll let.
We'll
you know.
Never know because yes,
in the inevitable.
First and foremost, we will never.
It will turn him into a Stretch Armstrong in the
right,
future.
Right,
and
right.
He's bald at the end of this movie.
Sure.
When does he get a haircut?
I don't know. You know what?
Did not notice this.
At least that new X-Men movie had the decency to show me Charles Xavier's hair falling out. Show me how Dalsim's hair falls out.
Oh, you think
out.
Apocalypse was involved in Dalsim's hair falling out?
Quite possibly.
I didn't see it.
It's unconfirmed. All right. What?
No spoilers. For
well, the, it turns out, Vin, Charles Xavier becomes a bald man.
Fuck!
But
but he still walks, right?
Yeah. He's good.
Dal seems like, I will now run with my creation, the Blanca. And Guile's like, don't go with that ugly piece of shit. Come with me. And he's like,
I have no shirt on right now.
I couldn't get you a date.
You'll be my new wingman. We'll go to the bars together. Sandals. I'm still in the middle of a sandals vacation, goddammit. But on his way out, he's like, but you said you did nothing wrong. He's like, well, if good men do nothing, isn't that evil enough? That's
yeah.
A little bit of grade school philosophy for you Street Fighter fans.
Guess I'll just die with this green radioactive monster with me.
or whatever.
So does the movie end at this point?
Yeah.
It pretty much ends at this point. There's it's revealed that treasure chest that DJ stole is just filled with fucking bison bucks.
Oh, shit, that's Confederate money.
And he never got around to kidnapping the queen.
Did you notice the part where when they discover it's bison bucks and Saget's just throwing them there, he trips?
Oh, did he really?
Yeah, he trips.
They didn't cut that one out,
they
huh?
They're like, ah, fuck it.
But also, Saget, the world's second biggest war criminal, is like 30 feet away from the AN who's like running apeshit. Like, I wouldn't be hanging around,
no,
bro.
Get back in that water.
Well, time
no,
to go.
Hang around, because if I know anything about world politics, is, you know, the AN will prop up Saget as a puppet dictatorship.
Oh, yeah, you're fine. Totally right.
Maybe that's his move.
The last trick that this movie plays on us is trying to convince us that fucking
60 people held captive because they only evacuate 10.
That
there were some casualties.
Oh no!
Oh,
you got to break a few eggs, make an omelet.
My friend Blanca got a little crazy.
At least we didn't lose any money.
No, they have the audacity to try to convince you that Guile might be dead at the end
of
this movie.
That's so stupid.
Because, like, you know, Castle Bison's call explodes and collapses on itself. And they're all standing around like, oh, hey, you know, where the hell's Guile?
We got to
get this, we got to get these credits going.
I thought I lost you, boy.
Yeah. And then Jean-Claude Van Damme just comes out of a couple of trees and he's like, I was here the whole time. And you're like, all right.
And then she...
I never thought you were fucking dead in the first place.
Chun-Li's
you
like,
didn't? So it's like he comes back and he's alive. And then they're like, yeah! And it's like the freeze frame, which is like a reference to the video
everyone
game.
Poses.
Everybody does
their
victory
thing,
pose.
The exact
oh,
thing.
Oh, God, it's such shit. And then the credits, and then there's a stinger scene.
Before the stinger scene.
We have to talk about two things. One,
I was watching the end of the game at this point. So.
Yo, you cut out?
I was like, fucking end this shit.
One is...
Wait. Vin, had you seen this movie before this episode?
No, I have.
Oh, all right.
Yeah. Very good. He's... One, it says Vaya con Dios, Raul, which is really, it's nice. It's
sure.
Touching.
He passed away before the movie came out.
It's nice. If that
sounds like, it sounds like it's mocking him.
Oh, wow.
It's a shitty movie.
Listen,
and
it's a, you're putting in like a Spanish expression.
Right.
You know, he was Puerto Rican. He passed away before the movie came out. If this was the only thing.
Yes.
At agreed. The end of this movie, it's totally fine and respectful.
Yep, yeah.
Raul, go with God. It's
and
totally
here's the
fun.
Credits is all the beautiful
yeah,
people
I'm cool
that work
with
this
that, yeah.
But no, they,
however,
they
yeah.
call, they got there's this running gag of this Good Morning Vietnam-esque radio DJ.
Oh my
that's
God.
The guy. That's the guy who was Good Morning Vietnam was based on.
Oh really?
Wait, that what? Dude. Wait.
Adrian well, Cronauer.
The actual guy from Vietnam or something. You're
what? Jesus Christ. No. Remember the Robin Williams movie Good
yeah,
Morning Vietnam?
It's dog shit.
Fine, I don't care. But the guy that Robin Williams is portraying in the movie...
This is the actual guy?
That's the actual guy.
That's what I was asking.
Adrian Cronauer. It's the actual guy that they based
sucks.
Good Morning Vietnam
that
on.
Really does
because earlier in the movie, there is a Good Morning Chandelier.
There absolutely is. And they do it at the end credits,
and
too.
And he's doing all these like popsicle jokes, which are jokes that you'd get on popsicle sticks about M. Bison Troopers. And like, how many M. Bison Troopers does it take to screw in a light bulb?
Oh,
and it's like... Whatever that bad.
The answer is one, and the other 49 shoot you to death afterwards.
Oh,
Bison Death Squad.
Sorry, Raul Julia. I'm stepping all over your dedication.
Yeah, exactly.
Stay in the theater, folks. I'm doing some Snapple trivia up next. Pop, did you know that an ant can carry over twice its own weight?
And now we just had this beautiful Raul Julia tribute, and now Adrian Cronauer with Snapple Fags.
And then we get...
By the way, one of the songs you hear in the theme...
Apparently. Hold the phone.
Do you know who performed one of the songs in the soundtrack? Music inspired by and included in the movie Street Fighter?
Jean-Claude Van Damme.
Hammer, formerly known as MC Hammer, and
what?
Deion Sanders.
What are you talking about? What song?
MC Hammer lost the MC?
Oh, yeah.
Oh, that happened.
Did the Repo
no one
Man
else is the name that's Deion Sanders?
Thank
You're
you.
More worried about the MC part. It's Deion Sanders.
Oh, what is that, Bernie Sanders' son?
Yes.
Football.
No, I know. He's a sports guy.
Football legend.
Played
Deion
hockey.
Sanders.
What song are they singing?
It's like one of the many bad hip-hop songs at the end of this film.
What's amazing, though, is that means there are now two movies starring Raul Julia that are also MC Hammer soundtrack related.
Oh, you think he went to the funeral?
Definitely.
Oh, yeah. Sure.
By Sang. Yeah. He just gets up to the microphone and very solemnly is like, they do what they want to do, say what they want to say. Adam's family. And then someone started playing the bagpipes.
And then everyone's like, wait, I thought he was Puerto Rican. What?
Why are they playing taps?
Well, I'm sorry.
What a terribly
he was
funeral.
In Street Fighter.
I apologize to the immortal soul of Raul Julia.
He's okay.
But then we get to this last thing, though.
Which is just M. Bison rising up from the rubble.
You know what, dude? Don't do that. Like, if you're going to do Vaya Con Dios, Raul, just don't do it. Like, you can, if this movie's such a massive success that there needs to be a sequel to it, you can find a way to organically make that in the next movie. But at least,
sure.
Like, but it's Vaya Con Dios. That's a nice thing to say to your actor that was dying on set,
right?
Practically, while Jean-Claude Van Damme punched him in the face. So maybe you don't need, like, his fist rising from rubble.
Here's the thing, though. You're missing the worst part of all of it. Because if it
the
was...
The movie?
The last hour and 14 minutes.
If it was just a fist up from this pile of TVs, it's terrible, but it's a fist up from a pile of TVs and it's over with. After that,
oh yeah,
there's this like close up on a computer screen. So the fist, we're told, it jumps up from a pile of TVs and then grabs a computer mouse...
Yeah,
and starts mousing over because then it's like, oh, good morning, Mr. Bison or whatever. And he opens a fucking folder that says world domination then it says replay.
What do you want to do, Mr. Bison? It would be like, first, let's get my skull together. Let's put that jigsaw back.
It's just fucking like
reconstructive surgery needs to be on the top of that list. World domination can happen tomorrow.
If they wanted to use replay,
yeah,
in the you know for the gaming aspect of it, they could have used it anywhere else.
Yeah, I do agree with
that's
you.
That's the thing.
Not, all right, cool.
Not
cool.
In a known to be now dead actor.
If there's one thing he's not
scene.
Doing, it's replaying.
It's. Oh, it's infuriating. It replay it's world domination.
Yeah. And you just totally gut the go with God. You know what? Congratulations.
Yeah. And then you spit on that.
Yeah.
Oh, would anybody recommend this movie?
No, we did this, 2 years ago for like a live show that
was
fun.
A while back, yeah.
And like, I really didn't need to see this movie again.
I know, that's why we've been so hesitant to redo this episode because of that live show.
Seeing this movie twice in 2 years is a lot of times to see this movie. I think I'm kind of done with it.
Yeah, I'll never watch this again. Hope, God willing. Vaya con Dios. But no, I will...
I do not recommend watching this movie.
I do not recommend this. I wouldn't wish this on my worst enemy.
Mortal Kombat's a superior movie. Hands down.
Yeah, no, definitely not. It's probably the worst video game adaptation for a movie. It's terrible.
I would rather watch a Super Mario Brothers movie.
Hands down.
Yeah, you're right.
I was
just about to ask it, but as soon as I was asking it and Steve said that, I realized, yeah, I would totally watch Mario Brothers
off. But at the same time, this is kind of a perfect 90s movie.
Oh, yeah.
Like, it fits the time. I was watching, I was like, is this an action movie? Is this a comedy? What am I? But it worked.
Yeah.
But it's horrible.
It's Andrew?
No, I would not recommend this movie. I was trying to figure out, like, you know, in my head, I was like, man, this is a hangover movie, but it's really not.
No.
It's so unwatchable, I feel.
Here's a question.
Yes.
No.
Can you make a Street Fighter movie now?
No.
Where Blanc is taking a shower.
Ooh, with Sagan.
Short film, though.
Yeah.
Black and white independent movie. You're leaving me hanging here. That's all right. I was going for Sagan. All right.
But like in the terms of now and like maybe you get a cool kung fu director to something.
I think nowadays you could definitely do something that's way more.
Well, they made that, what, the Street Fighter Legend of Chun-Li?
That's probably a stay tuned. I never saw it.
I never saw it either, but yeah. Two words, Chris Klein.
That's why I never saw it.
That's the only reason why you didn't see Street Fighter : The Legend of Chun-Li.
I'm a Street Fighter head, but it was like, oh, Chris Klein's in it.
He's also known as Box Office Poison.
But back to your point, Steve, I think if you get some cool like choreography, like an Ung Bak or like a Jason Bourne,
get Paul Greengrass.
You know what I mean?
Yes.
I think it'll work, man.
I'm into that idea.
I'm down. I want to see that now.
That's Street Fighter from 1994, directed by Stephen E. D'Souza. If you want more We Hate Movies, check out WHMPodcast.com or find us over at SideshowNetwork.tv. Like us on Facebook and follow us on Twitter. We are at WHMPodcast. And, of course, right into the mailbag, weallhatemovies@gmail.com. Rate and review the show wherever you subscribe. We would greatly appreciate it. Now, Vinny, you have your own program.
It's about 15 minutes long.
Yeah, that's all right.
It's about 4 in the morning.
Yeah, so just tell the folks. We have a lot of new listeners since you've last been on.
Sure. It's a 15-minute rant of my trip to the gym at 4:30 in the morning. It's basically a suicide note. That's going to come to fruition one day. So check it out. It's on iTunes. It's the Vinny Brusco Show.
And you're writing these suicide notes once a week?
It's twice a week. Tuesdays and Fridays.
Twice a week. That's a lot of content.
That's a lot of suicide.
15 minutes.
There's a lot of creepy content.
Oh, there's so much creepy content. But no, it's just kind of some random thoughts off the top of my head that involved everything and anything. So
except the Street Fighter movie.
No, it's all about Street Fighter. It's a 15-minute commute about Street Fighter.
We're talking Street Fighter. We're talking about taking my own life.
So there.
Next week on the program, the summer blockbuster extravaganza rolls on.
God damn it.
We get into the real meat of the summer right here. It's
another 48 hours.
Oh, God damn it. I'm back for a sequel no one asked for.
We're finally doing a Nick Nolte movie after doing his voice for years for no reason.
You should not use it once, though.
No.
Oh, no. It's plentiful.
Well, listen to us blow our voices out next week.
Yeah, I was going to say, we've already recorded it, and the episode is basically 76% Nick Nolte voices. I'm going to see how that edit goes.
It'll be great.
So next week with another 48 hours, I'm Andrew Jupin.
Steven Sadak.
Eric Siska.
Vinny Brusco.
Take it easy.